want to join the Bible study, look for the Zoom link info in our e-news, and we can get you connected that way. Also, we'll be having some Advent activities and happenings throughout Advent, which starts next Sunday. So check out your e-news for information on that as well. And of course, we have our communion cups up here, so feel free at any time to come up and sanitize your hands and grab a communion cup, and you'll be ready when we get to communion. And Pastor is handling some of the chair handing out chores here. So if anybody has any questions, please let us know. And with that, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Our beloved opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Shows us the way of service, and in him we inherit the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what is right and the strength to serve the world you have made. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated. Good morning. Now, Thanksgiving is coming up this week, and I don't know about you, but I really love Thanksgiving, and I am ready. Now, I think this year, though, Thanksgiving is a little more challenging for all of us, and maybe those challenges are a little simple. Maybe this is not the year, once again, that you're going to graduate from the kids' table, or maybe our challenges are a little more complex. We can't go and visit our families, or our families can't come and visit us. And so sometimes when we face those challenges, we may struggle a little bit with being thankful. But there is still so much to be thankful for during this Thanksgiving season. Even during the time of a pandemic, there are so many things that remind us of God's love. So let's be thankful. Now, I had something cross my desk a couple of weeks ago, and I thought it was pretty cool. I love to take credit for it, but I can't, so it's actually something from a company called Creative Communications, so I'm just going to hang that right here as a reminder. It was a brochure about not only giving thanks, but living thanks. And then it went on to describe ways that you could live thanks. Now, this is the children's sermon, so we're going to talk about what Jesus said instead. We can live our thanks by feeding the hungry, by giving those who are thirsty something to drink, by welcoming the stranger, by clothing the naked, by caring for the sick, and by visiting those in prison. Now, Jesus says that if you do this for the least of these, it's just like doing it for him. So we can put the face of Jesus on all of the people that we try to serve. Now, you may be sitting there going, well, I don't really know anybody who is hungry. We have a lot of hungry people. Yesterday at our food pantry, we gave out 101 bags of food to food insecure folks in Ward 3. So we do have hungry people in this ward, but maybe it's a different kind of hunger. Maybe you know someone who's hungry for companionship. Maybe that person would really like to get a card or a note from you. And maybe you don't know anybody in prison, but maybe you know someone who feels imprisoned because they can't leave their home during the pandemic. And you can pick up the phone and give them a call. And maybe you're a little hesitant to clothe somebody because you don't know what size they wear, what kind of clothes they like. But you can still look at other ways to clothe them in God's love. So this Thanksgiving, as we sit around our tables, we can look all around us and see who's missing and how we might better serve them, allowing us to not only give thanks, but to live our thanks. Let us pray. Gracious and heavenly God, thank you for the many gifts that you give us. Help us to live and give thankfully. Amen. Bring them into their own land, and I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the water courses, and in all the inhabited parts of the land. I will feed them with good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and they shall feed on rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak. But the fat and the strong I will destroy.
feed them with justice. Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Because you pushed with flank and shoulder, and butted at all the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide, I will save my flock, and they shall no longer be ravaged. And I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God. And my servant David shall be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Grace and peace to you from God. On this Christ the King Sunday, this last Sunday of the church year, when we proclaim Jesus the Christ, King of kings and Lord of lords, when we confess and profess God's reign and rule in our lives, there is an awful lot of talk about animals, about goats. Walking around in Africa, well, y'all, it ain't can recognize the faces of those they encounter, and some scientists say that they can recognize their own names.
Have you named your sheep?
Sheep also have good peripheral vision and can see behind themselves without turning their heads.
Reminds me of mother.
Yet sheep have trouble with depth perception, so they easily fall into holes and ruts and must be rescued. In our text from Ezekiel, we hear about the sheep that God rescues, sheep that have previously been mistreated by other shepherds. You see, the kings of Israel were often described as shepherds with charge over the people of God. In verses 1 through 10 of this chapter of Ezekiel, we are told of shepherds that have been feeding themselves at the expense of sheep. Shepherds, kings, rulers, or leaders that have abdicated their responsibility, have forgotten the task they have been set to, and abused their authority. Sound familiar? These leaders have not strengthened the weak, healed the sick, bound up the injured, brought back the strayed, or sought the lost. In the gospel, there is good news, however. The sheep are in the hands of God. And Ezekiel says, this God says, I will feed them with good pasture. Now, in the care of God, who seeks the lost, brings back the strays, binds up the injured, and strengthens the weak and the sick, this is indeed the way that sheep should be cared for, right? This we can all agree on, especially if we cast ourselves in the role of sheep. And so often we do. Don't we say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want? Well, not so fast. Along with the picture of God's overwhelming grace that we hear, there is also judgment. God speaks of disappointment with some of God's sheep. There seems to be some inter-flock rivalry. It's not just the shepherds that seem to be self-absorbed and selfish in the 34th chapter of Ezekiel. It is also some of the sheep. Some sheep are taking more than they need. Some sheep are not being considerate of others. Some sheep are growing fat on the back of the lean. Some sheep have extravagant shelter while other sheep are homeless. Some sheep have access to the best health care. Some sheep have no access. God says, I will strengthen the weak, but the fat I will destroy. We wonder what God will do with those who have gotten fat by pushing with flank and shoulder and butting all the weak animals with arms until they are scattered far and wide. Not that they were trying to hurt anyone. They were just trying to survive. Their families deserve a good life, don't they? These sheep trampling over the good pasture don't really have time to look out for the smaller, weaker sheep, do they? Perhaps they think if the leaders aren't going to look out for us, we look out for ourselves. The sheep are not like the shepherds intentionally taking advantage. After all, they really don't know what they are doing. In Matthew, we hear another one of those hard parables. I don't like it. I don't like being reminded that I'm a sheep, that I might indeed be a fat sheep, and I don't want to be a goat, because for the goat, just like the servant that buried his talent and the five foolish wise men made, things don't look so good. I don't want to contemplate the possibility if I don't get it just right, the right amount of oil, the right use of talents, or the right way of helping the least of these, that I don't get to inherit eternal life. Yet let's look a little closer. This judgment is tempered with grace. In the text, neither sheep nor goats know what they are doing. They didn't see Jesus. The sheep were possibly so absorbed with tons of things to do. Tons of people to feed, tons of prisoners to visit, tons of sick to heal, so busy that they made the least an object and did not see their faces. And the goats, well, they were too selfish to see Jesus. What Jesus is telling us is to pay attention, that we are not only called to help, but to see our neighbor and love them, to listen, observe what is going around us and in our world, to value the other and not be so caught up in ourselves that we miss the encounter, that we miss the opportunity to engage with the least. Because if we do, we risk missing people. I'm going to tell a story about someone who's sitting out here today, and I didn't ask their permission, but I hope that they will forgive me. I have come and watched the distribution of food at the food pantry. And someone who's been working at the food pantry for 12 years knows the people who come for food by name. And she never misses an opportunity, even if she's not the one to hand them a bag, to say, hello. Greet them and say their name. In this text, Jesus is saying, pay attention. I am with you. Don't miss me. Yeah. When did we see you? When did we feed you? When did we visit you? Jesus says, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. The writer of Matthew is trying to tell us something. He is offering us once again the opportunity to reflect on who we are, sheep or goats. Those who use or bury our talents, wise or foolish bridesmaids, those who live in fear are hope. While we take the time to figure out who we are and how we will live our lives, we remember the promise proclaimed by the prophet Ezekiel is a promise for all of us sheep, fat and lean from God. The promise, I will save my flock. I will set up over them one shepherd, and he will feed them and be their shepherd. The one who stands to judge, who separates the sheep from the goat, is the great shepherd. The one who is judge, the one who hung on a cross in our place for our sins, for our self-absorption and self-initiative, for our lack of attention to all those who are hurting and hungry around us, to fill in when we can't possibly get it right. This is the one who now sits as king on the throne at the right hand of God, the one who gathers us in the waters of baptism, the one who is the word in worship, the one who feeds us the Eucharist meal with his own body and blood, so that we may be strengthened to work in the world, to feed, to clothe, to visit, to heal, to see in the eyes of another. To participate in the riches of God's grace. ask that these gifts touch the sick, the lonely, and all those who use them in our church and community, enfolding them with your love and the prayers of your people. And we respond. God, may these prayer shawls and quilts be blessed in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please rise and let us profess our shared faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Sovereign of all, train our ears to hear your cry and the needs of those around us. Bless all social ministries of the church through which we seek to serve others as we ourselves have been served. Hear us, O God. You cause rain to fall on the just and unjust alike. Direct our use of creation to provide the needs of all people in ways that are sustainable for the earth. Hear us, O God. Bring peace to every place where conflict rages. Grant opportunities for ending divisions among us and usher in your reign of unity and reconciliation. Hear us, O God. Heal the sinful divisions we erect between us and release us from systems of oppression and prejudice. Restore our capacity to see your image in those whose dignity we have stripped away. Hear us, O God. Pour out the gifts of your Spirit on children and youth throughout the church. Sustain those who work in children's ministry, youth ministry, and campus ministry as they nurture the gifts of young people. Hear us, O God. Comfort those who are sick or suffering in any way. We pray especially for Judy Baumgartner, Aaron, Peggy Mayer, the family and friends of Marty Anderson upon her death, the family and friends of Charlie Albert upon his death, Carmen Ortiz, Carol Holler, the Ravana and Mahan families, Maggie, Jane, JJ, Barb Pitts, Carolyn Boston, Nishan and Takina, Levi, John Lassane, Julie Hamlin, Greg McAllister, the Carr family, Pearl Appison, Jillian Flory, Russell and Stephanie Thomas, Joan Tolbert, Stephanie Skrzynski, Barbara Hostage, Sue Erickson, Russell Stevens, Glenn Ralph, Betty Mastatista, Richard, Dallas Dean, Carolyn Dennison, Lois Leland, Bill Jackson, Grace Yin, Ralph Benson, Susan Russo, the Rademacher family, Neil, the Williamson family. We pray for all those affected in any way by the current pandemic. We pray for all Christians persecuted for their faith throughout the world. And we pray for those that we name out loud on our lips or silently in our hearts. Hear us, O God. thank you for saints now departed who fed the hungry, clothed the naked, and tended to the sick. Inspire us by their example that we may see your presence in those in need around us. Hear us, O God. Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. You may be seated.
And now for your filling offering point. The wind is blowing on this Christ the King Sunday. The candle is there, so your offering won't blow away. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name. Thank you.
night in which he was betrayed. Our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly feast, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor, now and forever. Now let us pray together the prayer our Savior taught us. The gifts of God for the people of God. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in the simple meal you have set at banquet, sustain us on the journey, strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children, and give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on the way. May the God of all creation and human whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for service, give you reason to rejoice and be glad. The blessing of God.